Good morning, everyone. Wherever you are in this world, I have a notification to pass on. And I received this notification last night from what I call now, I'm calling it super compassion. This is maybe a helpful term for everyone. And super compassion has declared a state of emergency for the United States of America. It has declared a state of emergency for the United States of America. So that is a notification. The ramifications of that are just, you know, it'll take a while for it to settle in. But it basically frees up help from super compassion now to come into the United States of America. Sort of similar to like when a state has some sort of natural disaster, like Hurricane Katrina for Louisiana. A state of disaster is declared in that area, and then this frees up like federal funding to come into the area, federal assistance, emergency housing, refugee status for those who have been affected by it. They're able to get this you know, housing and food and medical care and help to rebuild, and all this funding and help is able to come into this disaster area. Well, super compassion has declared the United States of America as a disaster area, as a state of emergency. So this enables the help to come in. So this is what is going on right now on August 21st. I'm an assistant. I've been asked to be an assistant for Super Compassion to pass on, to do what they asked me to do, and in this case is to pass on this notification to the United States and to the world that Super Compassion has declared a state of emergency for the United States of America. Now, this may not come as a surprise to most, right? It didn't come as a surprise to me. I said, yeah, right. It's perfect timing. Time to get with this help from Super Compassion. Now, Super Compassion is a much, much greater compassion than what we're used to. All right. We've heard this word compassion bandied a lot around it. A lot. The Dalai Lama speaks a lot about compassion, for instance, around the world. We need to be more compassionate. But really, super compassion is at a level of compassion that is so extraordinary that we really are not tuned into it much yet. We really are not. It's not the ordinary compassion we're used to. Not at all. Not at all. So it will take some getting used to. I've spent 49 years completed 49 years of getting used to super compassion, and I'm, you know, still working at it constantly, getting used to it. But we can get used to it. We can get used to it. So the help that we were able to receive right now in the United States with this declaration of state emergency in the United States is that this we're able to get this assistance from super compassion. And I saw how it's like light streaming in. This unexpected light comes streaming in. The light of super compassion comes streaming in. And it's like we say, oh, what is this? This is so wonderful. And the old ways of compassion give way to this new way of super compassion. And it's absolutely necessary right now for the United States. It's absolutely necessary that we start receiving assistance from this super compassion. And I don't know, you know, all the forms that it will take at all. I just saw that there's this suddenly this like opening in this dark clouds, and this beautiful light comes streaming in. It is really quite extraordinary to experience this. So I didn't sleep at all last night. I really have been feeling this since yesterday, since the eclipse, which here in the Bay Area was kind of, the eclipse got eclipsed. It really didn't happen much at all. It was like, what, you know, where, you know, where was it? Much ado about nothing. But certainly I felt my balance was all out of whack. My equilibrium was out of whack. I said, wow. Felt very clumsy and very jittery. and spent my time writing about super compassion, really. I did about over 14,000 words I wrote, and I'm working on putting out some information about super compassion. But it's not easy to explain this. It's not easy because the old ways of compassion, they have to be dislodged. And I saw that last night in sort of a semi-sleep state, sort of dozing on and off. I saw this light come streaming in, and this old the old ways of compassion that had been idolized for so long here. This figure was toppled from its pedestal. It was toppled and fell to the ground. This is the old way of compassion, which really has not served us very well, has it? And it's really time, especially in the United States. I believe the United States is a forerunner in this super compassion, because we really need it. We're really struggling. It's really terrible right now, and so it's like when your house is on fire, you tend to call 911, don't you? So some of us here have been calling 911 for quite some time, calling super compassion, saying, "Help! We really need help because this is headed for trouble here," and it most certainly is. So in when there's a fire, you get out of the house as quickly as possible, right? You call for help. You get out of the house, get help. We don't worry too much about all the details. Now, the details will start emerging as we go along about super compassion, and I'll see what I can do to help with that. It's really a much new level of compassion. It is so much greater compassion. And as I said before, we haven't been very well served by the old compassion. We really haven't. It's brought us to this the brink of these troubles that we have. I call it the spirituality of panic. The old compassion is the spirituality of panic. Okay. Whereas super compassion is more the spirituality of shock. But shock is very different than panic. Very, very different. Shock is like a bridge between panic and peace. Okay, panic and peace. So we're in a state of shock now, but that's a really great thing because a state of shock is able to be aware of and receive help from super compassion. It's no longer really in a state of panic. Panic, it's not. The state of panic has a whole spirituality, system of spirituality, a whole belief system that includes a lot of spirituality. But it's really in service to panic and trying to make panic normal. Okay, make it seem like more normal. And this hasn't worked well for us at all, has it? Our house is on fire here in the United States. And we, those who are very sensitive to this, realize, hey, the old ways, they have to give way. They have to be dislodged from their pedestal. And they have. I saw last night, truly, super compassion has dislodged the old style compassion, which is really the spirituality of panic, which is another way of saying the spirituality of absurdity. The spirituality of absurdity has its own style of what it calls compassion, and it's compassionate to its goals. Okay, but its goals aren't really compassionate to what we really are. Okay, what we truly are. So we have not really been compassionate to what we truly are. We've been compassionate to the attempt to change what we are, right? Which has led to a state of panic and a state of suffering for us. All right? And we haven't really been able to get to super compassion. But a lot of us realize, hey, this something is really not working properly. And it's really the old way of compassion is not working properly because it's in service to a premise that we're supposed to change what we are. And this isn't true. It's a false premise. It's a false premise. It's a premise which is ultimately based on the notion that the universe has been created by God, okay? Which is really a false premise. It's a false premise. The universe is really our handiwork, the handiwork of creativity trying to change what it is, okay? But this is not the handiwork of the prime creator, God the prime creator. It is not. The universe is absolutely not the handiwork. So really the universe, I get into this in my writings and in the videos, you've heard me get into this. It's really an attempt to change what we are. The universe is an attempt for what we call creativity, our spirit. I'm calling it creativity now. I like that term, creativity, to destroy itself. It's really an attempt for creativity to destroy itself. And through the destruction of itself, create a new reality, a new reality. The reality based on the destruction of creativity. So I assure you that this is not God's creation. God did not create creativity to destroy itself. Okay, let you be assured of this fact. So super compassion is based on a genuine, true recognition of what the universe is really about. Okay, and how we're able to gently and graciously exit from this attempt to destroy what we are. Creativity is trying to destroy creativity. And this universe is how it's trying to accomplish this. The universe, the galaxies, the planet, the stars, the planets, the spatial distance between all of this stuff, the forms, nature, the life forms, all of this universe is really creativity trying to destroy itself. And we haven't yet been able to see that. The old way of compassion doesn't recognize this. It doesn't recognize this. It believes the universe is created by God, or it's fundamentally good, and that we're life forms, or this is true life, these body life forms is the life that this God has created. And it goes on and on. It has a whole belief system trying to sanctify this attempt of creativity to destroy itself. And this hasn't worked well, has it? We're really continuing on with this destructivity, aren't we? And there isn't really any need for that. Creativity doesn't need to try and destroy itself. This was just a whim of adventurousness on the part of creativity. It says, hey, I'm perfectly creative. I'm perfectly free. I can flow in any way I want to. This is reality. Creativity flowing through creativity ceaselessly in the instant. Absolutely free, unobstructed, totally unobstructed. And creativity felt like, hey, I'm so creative. I wonder if I can undo this creativity. And it felt like this was a really interesting adventure for creativity, like the ultimate adventure. I wonder if I can destroy creativity. I wonder if I can use my creativity to destroy creativity. And so this is what creativity did. It took up this idea of, you know, can I destroy creativity? And through this destruction of creativity, create a new reality. And so this desire to see if this adventure, the desire to adventure in this way, to be creative in this way, took the dream shape of a universe. So this is what's really been going on. This is what's really been going on. And so super compassion is aware of this. All right. And you know, there may be some in the world who want to cling to the old compassion, but you know, they may very well change their tune pretty soon, right? So I'm not putting it past anyone here, anyone quote unquote in this world, in this dream world, dream figures in a dream world, really, dream of obstruction, you know, that creativity believes it has to flow around things, you know, instead of through everything. Creativity flows through itself. Okay, but the universe, the creativity is trying to say, oh, there's all these obstructions, you know, all these obstructions. I have to flow around things and flow around life forms. There's a separate creativity within life forms, and I have to flow around. And this is not so. This is just a dream of obstruction. There's really no obstruction at all. But I don't put it past anyone, any dream figures in a dream world here, to change their tune, to change their tune. So I'm addressing everyone here, giving a notification to everyone. And not saying to anyone, oh, you know, you're definitely going to, you know, hang in there with the old compassion and go through this, all this imagined destructivity. I'm not going to condemn anyone, say for sure you are, you're not going to get with the new way of super compassion. Because who knows? Suffering can really turn the tide in unexpected ways. That is for sure. And you might have the historic example, like might be Saint Paul, right? Who was the number one persecutor and prosecutor, actually, of early Christians, of the apostles, the real early Christians. He was the number one bad guy, and they said he was the one least likely to ever, you know, see the light that they were seeing, which was really an early glimpse of super compassion, actually. An early glimpse of super compassion is what those apostles were seeing, and they were glimpsing it, you know, dimly in certain ways, but they did get an early glimpse of super compassion. And St. Paul was the number one opponent of that, and he was having some of them actually put to death. That's how bad he was. That's what he was into. And lo and behold, you know, St. Paul turned out to be one of the greatest exponents of super compassion, early exponents of it, from a historical standpoint. And we certainly praise his efforts, even though he admitted that his understanding of super compassion was in its very early rudimentary stages. This is certainly true. But because of someone such as like St. Paul, we're much clearer about super compassion than we would have been. You know, we had to break the ice at some point. I mean, there's been various historical epochs where the ice on super compassion has been broken. And there are those who've got glimpses of it and began to be associated with it and get used to it a little bit, right? But by and large right now in the world, there's kind of an apathy and a dullness in relation to super compassion. We have really stalled out into the old ways of compassion. Very badly stalled out, which is really the compassion of absurdity. Believing that if we can just stall out and delay long enough in chronic absurdity, chronic panic, chronic abnormality, that this will somehow be magically transformed into the new normal. And this will be now the new normal, meaning the new reality of creativity flowing around obstructions. This is the old compassion is in the service of this, really. But that doesn't mean that we haven't made progress throughout the many centuries here. We have. So I'm an example of this, of some progress, actually, in relation to super compassion. And I made this progress because of the progress in all the centuries past here. I was able to tune into that and get some momentum from it, as well as getting glimpses of super compassion myself, direct glimpses and experiences of it. So I realized, wow, you know, this is really legitimate. What those in the past talked about is they got glimpses of super compassion. I realized, hey, you know, this is, you know, valid. I understand that they had these direct experiences of it. Now, it gets muddled through the centuries of description, you know, and trying to combine the old compassion and the new super compassion and you know, all of that, it gets muddled. But the original glimpses of it, I can tell, yeah, because I've had these glimpses as well, and I realized they indeed did have legitimate glimpses of and experiences of super compassion. And there are even some that came into the world who had steady awareness of super compassion. Steady awareness of super compassion, like Buddha and Jesus, etc. They had steady awareness of super compassion. But this is historically has been very rare, actually, very, very rare. Maybe more than we realize, but still, you know, quite rare. For the most part, there have been glimpses of super compassion here and there. But I'll tell you, glimpses of super compassion are better than no glimpses at all. They're actually very helpful. They might be initially, you know, kind of confusing, like, you know, whoa, I thought I knew what compassion was, and now I see in compassion in a very different light. And, you know, how can I integrate the two? And then that's when confusion arises. So really, it's very important to understand that you don't integrate the two. One supplants the other. One supplants the other. You don't integrate the two. It's this attempt to integrate that. It's like trying to integrate absurdity with truth. Yeah. Absurdity is an attempt to destroy truth. And so you gently and graciously set it aside. Gently and graciously set it aside. That's what you actually do. And you don't try to integrate it. So we've, you know, the big mistake we've made historically is the attempt to integrate truth and lies. Truth and absurdity. Now, you can't have the idea of trying to destroy creativity and at the same time be freely flowing through creativity. All right. The two are mutual exclusives in terms of experiencing. So what super compassion tells us is that we can gently and graciously, through honoring our creativity, set this desire, this misadventure aside. We can set it aside and say, you know, not now, not now. That's enough for now. I don't want to do that anymore. And we do this through honoring our creativity, that we were very creative in doing this. We don't hate ourselves. We don't try to attack ourselves, or, you know, don't try to kill it off. We honor this fact that we had this great misadventure. All right? We had this great misadventure. But we recognize indeed it was a misadventure. The attempt to do the impossible, to change what we are, to change our freedom. But we're in this very super compassionate state of honoring our creativity. We hate the suffering that we've had, all right? And we don't really like this idea anymore. And yet, at the same time, we honor our creativity, that we really were very, very creative in trying to destroy our creativity, right? So you know, there's a saying, hate the sin but love the sinner, right? And this is actually sort of a super compassion. You hate the sin but you love the sinner. So we hate this idea of trying to destroy ourselves, but we love the creativity that we brought to it. We love the creativity we brought to it. So this is really super compassion. So there has been some super compassion at work in the world throughout the ages. But again, it has stalled out at this point. We've kind of reached this impasse where we really need to get with the program of super compassion in a full, wholehearted way right now, and not in just kind of a half measure way. And you know, for instance, if you go to church, I attend church every week. And it's just, I'm just monitoring everything, really. Okay, I'm just monitoring everything. I happen to attend Catholic church. I'm not a baptized Catholic or a confirmed Catholic, I'm just there to just see how it's all going. It's a really easy way to see how it's really going. And really, honestly, they all know that it's stalled out. The priests know. They're very much aware of that. And everyone in the congregation is really, or many are aware, you know, we've stalled out. But, you know, they don't quit, but the priest will just kind of pretty much talks all the time. Homilies are like, you know, folks, basically what the priest saying, you know, folks, we've stalled out, and that's not a good thing. And to summarize it all, that's what the priests are really saying. We've stalled out, at least the wise ones. We've stalled out, and that's not such a good thing. How many people, you know, are doing this? Nobody. Okay, folks, we've stalled out, haven't we? And that's not a good thing, right? And everyone goes, yeah. And everyone's kind of silent and say, yeah, it's not a good thing at all. But they don't know what to do about it, okay? They don't know what to do about it. But at least there's this awareness that, hey, we've stalled out. Globally, we've stalled out. And especially the United States of America is a situation where this is coming to a head, where we've stalled out. And there's this sort of frenzy arising in the country because we realize we've stalled out, but the country doesn't know what to do, doesn't know what to do about it, is not aware of super compassion. It's very caught up in this spirituality of absurdity, of panic, very caught up in this. And it's not working. It's not working at all. It's kind of like blending, science and spirituality, integrating this. It's caught up in this whole integrating thing. We need to integrate everything, and it just hasn't worked. It's not working, and it doesn't work. It doesn't work. It's the great error. Okay. Jesus told us what? Don't put new wine into old wineskins. You cannot serve two masters. Now, you'll be disloyal to both. In other words, you don't try to integrate super compassion with panic compassion. Okay? Different premises entirely. Panic compassion is basically saying, we'll try to find a way to get used to being destroyed. Okay? We'll try to, heal that wound of creativity destroying itself and get used to the new reality where we have to flow around, where we're obstructed, creativity obstructed. It's trying to be compassionate, saying, yeah, that this is the new reality is this creativity has destroyed creativity and we'll be, suffering forever, really, this wound, but we'll try to heal it somehow. We'll try to be nice about it. We'll try to get used to it. If we just get used to it, maybe it'll be okay. That's the old compassion. That has no possibility of ever working. For creativity to try and destroy creativity, that's always going to be fearful and suffering. Okay. Bad suffering. Bad, severe fear, severe suffering. There's no way we can have our cake and eat it too. There's no way. And super compassion tells us this. So again, to reiterate, super compassion has declared a state of emergency for the United States of America. State of emergency. As of this day, August 21st, 2017. And we're just kind of looking at this, all right, together here. And in a calm, super compassionate way, we're calm, we're clear, we're insightful. At the same time, we're being very factual and direct. We're not trying to integrate the old and the new, okay? The two styles of compassion. The compassion of panic is compassion in name only, okay? It's not really being compassionate. Trying to adjust to a chronic state of panic is not really compassionate. It's not. It's kicking the can down the road, and we're now paying the price for kicking that can down the road. Especially here in the United States, and we are really, really paying the price, and that's not a surprise. It should come as a surprise to many, and it's led to this state of emergency being declared for the United States by super compassion. That's how bad it is. And if we hold on to the old style of compassion, we'll keep kicking the can down the road, and we will find out how that works out. Okay. And I'm in no mood to find out how that works for myself. Ultimately, compassion is for ourselves, right? And what are we? What are we really? We're creativity. We're perfect creativity, absolutely free to flow in any which way. To never encounter limitation or obstruction. There is no limitation or obstruction. Creativity flows through itself every instant. That's what we really are. So compassion is for that, for what we are, for creativity. It's creativity being compassionate to creativity. It's not creativity being compassionate for some new creativity arising out of the destruction of creativity. There is no such destruction of creativity. Okay. Creativity cannot destroy itself. It cannot even obstruct itself in any way. But it can pretend that it is obstructed, and that's what creativity has been doing. This universe is really a massive pretension by creativity. That's all it is, massive pretension. It's pretending. It's pretending, oh, I'm so obstructed, you know. I'm so bound by time, space, process, and form. You know, I have to function through these stars and planets and space and this structure. And I have to flow around all this stuff, you know, all this time, space, process, and form. And none of that is true. It's like, you know, how long does it take a dream of a billion years? How long does it take to flow through that idea of a billion years? Well, instantly, right? The idea of a billion years is being thought of right now. So how much time does it take to change that thought, to flow through that thought? It's done in an instant, in an instant. So the idea of a universe can be flowed through in an instant, just in an instant. It doesn't take any time for creativity to flow through this idea of trying to destroy what it is. It flows through it instantly, actually. And we say, whoa, I want it to take a little bit of time. Well, sure. So gentle and gracious setting aside is we don't do it, you know, immediately, abruptly, intense, and too intensely. We honor our creativity a little bit, right? We've been so creative. Such creative pretense. Even though it's pretense, it's been very, very creative, right? Absolutely, it has been. So, we spend some time tipping our own hat, you know, tip our own hat to our own creativity. Like, wow, what an amazing pretense this has all been. So we're very, very gentle and gracious. So what super compassion brings to us is this very gentle graciousness. And it will bring an environment, surroundings to us of very gentle graciousness. Now, how it will do this, we'll find out. We'll find out. I don't want to get ahead of myself here. It's a discovery that we look forward to. How does this happen? Because it certainly doesn't feel like in the United States right now that we're headed towards a very gentle graciousness, does it? Seems like we're headed very much in the opposite direction. And indeed we are. That's why a state of emergency has been declared by super compassion for the United States of America, the good old US of A. Who would have thunk it, huh? Well, if you could see the writing on the wall, a lot of us have thunk it. Said, wow, you know, the writing has most certainly been on the wall for quite some time, actually. As they say, you sow the wind, you reap the whirlwind. Okay, you scatter the seeds of wind, and the crop of that, as it grows and grows and grows, it turns, you know, the fruit of sowing the seeds of wind, it turns ultimately into the whirlwind. That's what you reap. That's what you harvest, and you harvest the whirlwind. And so the United States of America is now, you know, the harvest is starting to come in, and it's a whirlwind. So, super compassion is determined that it's time to render assistance, And it is. I certainly feel that. I certainly feel, you know, I need assistance. Like I'm a refugee. You know, it's like a whirlwind, a tornado is taking place, and you're saying, wow, I got to, you know, get away from that tornado, and I need some place to stay. I need the necessities, the bare necessities of life. I need, you know, some comfort. I need some, you know, counseling. I need to recover from it. I need to move on with my life. All this kind of stuff. It's like that. So super compassion is here to help us with all of that. It's here to help us with all of that. We're not counting on the old ways of compassion anymore. We're counting on super compassion. Whatever the old ways of compassion could do, super compassion can do that in tremendous amount more. tremendously more, vastly more, vastly more, vastly more, vastly better in both quantity and quality, vastly more in both quantity and quality. Okay, so we don't need to lean on the old compassion, which was really compassion in name only. Yeah, it's like saying, yeah, you're going to die, but don't worry, we'll give you a good funeral, you know? it's like, yeah, creativity, you're going to be destroyed, but we'll give you a real nice funeral. I think I want a different, better compassion than that, right? Don't we all? Don't we all? Do we really just want that nice funeral? Is that the heights of our, you know, aspiration, really? We have to say, yeah, creativity got no choice, it's going to destroy itself. We're going to destroy ourselves, but we'll have a nice funeral. So I'm sitting there in church, I'm looking around, everybody's telling themselves, yeah, I'm going to destroy myself, but I'm going to get a nice funeral. And they kind of like, kind of smile, and they're not smiling so much. Nobody really smiles so much. They're thinking like, huh, can't I do better than this? Can't I do? That's in the back of everyone's mind, you know, even the priest's mind. The priests even allude to that sometimes, like, you know, can't we do better than this? There must be some way to do better than this. Well, fortunately there is. Fortunately there is. So day by day, we just get used to it. I mean, it's kind of a shock. I mean, I've been preparing for it, but it's still quite shocking. I really couldn't sleep. I'm really just suffering right now because, you know, the old ways of compassion have now been supplanted. And when super compassion steps in, it's going to do it its way. It's going to do it its way, okay? It's not here to integrate the two ways. It's here to do it its way. It's confident in itself that it is truly gentle and gracious, and it truly understands, was wise enough to help us honor our creativity before we, you know, set this kind of misadventure really aside. Very farcical misadventure, to be nice about it. I mean, it's been a rather scary adventure, right? Very frightening adventure. Creativity trying to destroy itself, that's very frightening because, you know, we're very, you know, perfectly creative. So it seems as though that we have the potential to do this, right? We can make it seem like it's plausible. And that's what we've done. We've made it seem like it's plausible. And that's very scary for us. And all we can do when we feel that it's plausible is like, wow, I hope I have a great funeral, you know, and maybe I'll rise from the dead and there'll be a new creativity, a new reality. That's pretty much all we can do with it, right? But super compassion comes in and tells us, look, even though it seems plausible, it's not really possible at all. So be assured it's not possible that we can harm ourselves in any way, that we can diminish ourselves in any way. It's not possible at all. We can pretend, but it's not possible. So this gives us a big sigh of relief. Wow. Wow, wow, wow. What great relief that is. And so we kind of we have an opportunity now to get used to this great relief, this great relief. And obviously I'm kind of, you know, tired now, stressed out. I don't have a lot of confidence and energies. My voice is kind of tired because it's been a very stressful time. There's no question about it. I've been feeling it very strongly. You know, will we get the help? Will we get the help? Will we get the help? You know, I believe so. I believe so. Now I've been told yes, officially. We're now officially in the era of super compassion. In a state of emergency of the United States, we're officially now getting help. We've been notified officially. We're now officially getting help. It's happened. It's happened. So that's a huge, huge relief. Because I was told that to expect that very likely we would be getting help, very likely. I wasn't told, 100% for sure, 99%, but they didn't want to say for sure it's going to go this bad, because that would have scared me, too much. They said, it's very likely. We're on a standby. I was told, that this state of sort of a prepare for a state of emergency to be declared. So that's what I've been doing. Prepare for a state of emergency to be declared. It's very likely it will be declared, but it wasn't 100% for sure. Now it's 100% for sure. It has been declared. So we're in a different era right now, right? We're in a very different era right now. And I can't say it's going to be declared other places. I can't say a global state of emergency is going to be declared. I can't say that yet. It's very likely. But I can only say that for the United States of America, Super Compassion has declared a state of emergency, which opens up the door now for assistance to come in. And not a minute too soon, I'll tell you that. Not a minute too soon. Because, we really need it here. We really need it. We need Super Compassion. And we're going to get it. So that's what a way to open your day. Is just tremendous great news, isn't it? Tremendous great news. I know many of you are viewing this are different countries, other countries throughout the world. But you can't help but feel, at least some relief in hearing this, because United States, how it goes, it's very, very globally influential, to say the least. And I know everyone's probably quite jittery about what's going on in the United States right now. And the way it's being spun is not really what's going on. That's the old compassion spinning the story. Okay. Don't pay attention to that anymore, all right? Old compassion has its own spirituality, and it spins things according to that, and so it has its narrative, and yet that old compassion has been supplanted. Okay, so don't think that we know what's really going on. It's difficult, really. Most of us are confused, about what's really going on here. So don't think that I'm agreeing with the narrative of old compassion. The old compassion. I don't agree with it at all. It's quite different. It's quite different than what we're used to hearing. So Super Compassion has its perspective. And it's a very different outlook. Very gentle and gracious outlook. A very gentle and gracious outlook, which sees that everyone can sing a different tune. Everyone can turn to super compassion, right? There are no good guys, there are no bad guys, kind of thing, right? It's just the old ways of compassion didn't work. We're suffering from that in many ways. Everyone here is suffering from it. And some say they're suffering from it this way. Some say they're suffering from it this way. We're projecting our suffering onto others. And we're polarizing. Say, you're the good guy. We're good. You're bad. There's so much self-righteousness in the United States right now. And it's self-righteousness bordering, on violence, violent indignation. There's so much violent indignation on all sides here in the United States. Everywhere. Okay. That's the result of the old compassion failing. And it's a demand, we deserve something better. Everybody feels we deserve something better. And old compassion is saying, no. What we have is the best there is for you. A lot of people are saying, no, wait a minute, it's not good enough. The old regime is saying, no, it's the best there is, and we know how to do this. It's the best there is. You have to accept this. And so many are saying, well, no, it's not good enough. We're tired of this suffering. There's got to be something better. But they don't know what it is, so they get kind of weird, right? There's a lot of weirdness in the United States right now. But super compassion understands this, that people are getting really weird in their demands, and maybe we can find something in this way, or maybe we can find it in this way. So people are acting out in ways that they're getting condemned, and it seems very weird. And so there's this, the old regime of compassion is saying, you know, everybody has to continue on with this. This is the only way. And we, you know, so many realize, you know, it doesn't work. And so, you know, they can't be fooled anymore, you know. They can't be fooled anymore. They're saying, wow, it's just, no. They're saying no. And that's that being acted out in all sorts of ways. Again, so this is really an emergency. This is an emergency. What has to happen is we have to start getting used to super compassion. That's what has to happen. We've reached this impasse where enough people have realized that you know, this old compassion just there's something wrong with it. It just isn't it. It just isn't it. It doesn't really work. And we don't know why it doesn't work. Most don't know why. And so it's kind of this aimlessness, and a lot of frustration, a lot of shouting, a lot of anger, a lot of indignation. And it's all of this mixture, it's turmoil. This is what happens when enough people find out that what we've been doing, you know, doesn't really work. And yet there's this sort of intermediate stage where you're not sure what works. So we're entering into this intermediate stage, and we've been warned that this was likely to happen. And I call it like a 7-year cycle. I call it between the two eclipses here in the United States. We've had the first eclipse. There's another one in 2024. And it's like a 7-year cycle. And the 7-year cycle for the United States, at least, is a time where we need to get used to super compassion. It's that simple. It's the only way it's going to calm down. It's the only way it's going to calm down. We're not going back to the old compassion here. It's not going to happen. It's not going to happen. If we try to force that, there's going to be civil war here. Okay? If we try to force the old compassion upon this country, it's going to end up in civil war. So we don't want to do that. We don't want to do that. I don't believe that many want to do that at all here. I don't think hardly anyone really wants that. Maybe no one here. We really don't. We really don't. So this is why super compassion now steps onto the scene, steps onto the stage and says, hey, we're going to do it this way. This is how we move forward. And you just have to get familiar with super compassion. Just start getting familiar with it. This is the way forward for the United States. I can't speak for every country at this point on the planet. If I get notifications, you know, that may be another story, but I'm speaking for the United States at least right now. The way forward for the United States is to start getting used to super compassion. And we'll be given that opportunity. We'll be given that opportunity. How great is that? Both for the United States and really for the rest of the world. We're going to be given that opportunity now. And, you know, 7 years may seem like a long time, but 7 years spent in getting used to super compassion will be a good beginning. Let's put it this way. It'll be a good start. It takes longer than that. I've been at it for 49 years, okay, and I still have a ways to go, really, and I'm looking forward to that. I'm looking forward to these next 7 years where I have an opportunity to get even more familiar with super compassion. So it's a great, great opportunity for us in the United States. We have an opportunity to be the world leaders again, you know, really. The United States has really, for a while now, been really the world leaders in terms of trying to innovate as far as what works, okay. So that's why there's this turmoil in the country, because we were so innovative here. We don't take the old ways, we don't take no for an answer, we don't take the old ways of compassion, which is really just absurdity and panic, as a dead end. You say, you know what? Isn't there some innovation? Isn't there something better than this? And I live in the Silicon Valley here of San Francisco Bay Area my whole life, I have. And this is like the heart of innovation of the United States and really the world. And so the mood here is, you know what? there must be something better, right? And so I've always felt like, you know, there is something better, and it's just I have to find out what it is, and I have to get familiar with what it is, and it's super compassion. That's what it really is. So I've discovered super compassion as I've really, really worked to find something better. Indeed, there is something better, way better, way better, immeasurably better. We don't even worry about measuring how much better. It's the ticket, you know, it's really the ticket. It's the ticket for creativity to ultimately no longer play with this idea of trying to destroy creativity, destroy what it is. It's the ticket. Super compassion is the way home, so to speak, for us. But before we do that, we honor our creativity for a while, but without pushing that creativity, without saying we got to keep doing it, we got to really try to double down on it. We say, no. We're going to set it down, but before we do, we're going to spend some time, you know, we're going to be gentle and gracious about it. Gentle and gracious about how we set it down. So this really is the new way of super compassion. And this is how we go forward here in the United States, at least not for now. We're going to be afforded this opportunity to start getting used to super compassion here. And we're ready for it. I'm ready for it. I'm ready for it. You know, the preparatory work has been done. So yeah, this is just the next step. For me, it's just the next step to take. Okay, today this is the next step to take, and ready for it. But we'll spend at least 7 years doing that. At least 7 years to make a little star. It's like a little seed we plant, and give it 7 years to turn into a seedling. You know, right? Give it 7 years to turn into a seedling. We don't dig it up after. You know, you don't plant a seed and dig it up the next day. Say, what, are there any roots? Any roots? You know, let you know, water it. You know, let the seed germinate, and then let the seedling come up, and let it start putting up a few branches, and let the root system develop enough so you realize, hey, this tree can really grow. This can really grow into a fruit tree, you know, and bear fruit. And so give it 7 years to get a start. So 7 years of familiarity with super compassion will give us a little start. To it, a little start. It'll take longer than that to get totally familiar. It takes a while. It takes a while. It can take a lifetime or even more to get familiar with it, and even beyond that. But it's a wonderful way to spend your time, to spend your life. It's a wonderful way because it really is the ticket home for us. Okay. It's the ticket home. So this is what's going on in the good old US of A today. This is what's happening right now, today. Not a moment too soon, that's for sure. And so we're rejoicing here, and rejoice for us that this is now taking place here in the USA. It's the wild card that you know, many didn't expect. You know, they're in a state right. We're in a state right now. Many that we just feel like there is no answer. Oh my goodness! You know, we're going to head towards civil war. Everything. You know, it's just terrible. You know, people are like really on edge, to say the least. Really on edge. Because they don't expect it. They don't know what to expect. But because they don't really realize there is this super compassion. Maybe deep down there's a little bit of like, maybe there's something, right? But yes, there is this super compassion. There's no doubt about it. So this will start taking the edge off of the angst here in the United States. It will start taking the edge off the angst is what's going to happen. Now, as the edge is taken off that sharp knife of angst, as we go towards just a nice sort of nice dull butter knife here, right? So we're not on edge with one another so much here. We don't really want to be that way. We really don't. We're a wonderful country, actually, with wonderful people here, actually. And you know, it's very tough to see, you know, how we've become so on edge with one another here. we're a nation of hopefulness here. We're a nation of immigrants here, where we come here for out of hopefulness for to find something better, where we feel like the old ways haven't served us so well enough, and we're looking for a new way. This is why my ancestors came here. You know, everyone's ancestors, other than the Native Americans, but ultimately they came here too long ago. They came here searching for a new way. Okay, they came here out of positive hope, great enthusiasm and hope. Well, except for the slaves. Okay. Okay, that's a different story. That's another part of the fabric of America. That's part of the uncomfortable mix that's going on right now. It's like, we didn't come here out of hope. Yeah. But with that important caveat in mind, that there is this hopefulness here in the United States, that we came here to find something better. And so this attitude has permeated the country for so long here that when you feel full of hope, that, you know, we look at one another and say, I feel that we can, I have this hope, and I feel we can find something better, and you do too. And so there's been this feeling of brotherhood and cooperation here, right? And this is what is broken down now. It's really broken down. And there's no longer that feeling that cuts across any issues. It's like, because before we were experimenting. Maybe this will work. Maybe this will work. Maybe this will work. And we didn't feel like, well, you know, this has to work. If it doesn't work, we'll find something better. So we left the old ways behind. There's old way of saying, no, this is what you have to do. This old style compassion. This, you must do this. We left that behind and saying, you know, let's search for a new way. So if there's some ideology that we don't like, we say, well, maybe this isn't so great. You know, maybe we can find something better. So we weren't at each other's throats so much in the past, really. The disagreements were saying, oh, well, you know, you don't like this, you know, leader or this social issue or this something. Well, okay, maybe, you know, I'm not totally sold on. I mean, we're trying this, but the whole point is, let's innovate, let's try this, and let's find something that we all love here. Well, obviously, we haven't found that, have we? Have we found something that we all love here in the United States of America at this point? Obviously not. So there's this attempt to say, you know what? We need to stop innovating in the old ways. Let's go back to the old compassion, and that's it. Let's just label it new compassion. But it's really the same old compassion, isn't it? It's the same old premise. The premise has not been changed. No matter what kind of label you put on it, it's still the old compassion. Super compassion is fundamentally different than the old compassion. It really is. It's so extraordinary. The hope that we get through super compassion is really unbounded hope. It's really unbounded hope. You know this is it. There's no question about it. You know it. Just like those apostles, those who were around, those who brought in the super compassion in the past. Some of these great spiritual figures of history, those around them, they got these glimpses of it, and they knew this is really it. There's no question about it. This is unbounded hope. There's unlimited hope. This, I see home. I see creativity as it's meant to be. I feel it. I've experienced it. Oh my gosh, creativity flowing through creativity in the now. That's reality, right? with no limitation of how it expresses the now. No crystallization into some form, into some obstruction, into some process. None of that whatsoever. Always free in 360-degree freedom in every direction to flow through itself moment by moment by moment. That's reality. And there are those who have glimpsed that and they know this is it. This is it. So they know it. And this is the feeling you get with super compassion. You really know that this is it. And conversely, you know the old compassion of, you know, let's try to find some comfort within absurdity, within panic, fear, suffering, absurdity. Let's just try to find some way to adjust to that. You know, the idea there must be some way to adjust to that. Here, let me help you adjust to the destruction of creativity and a new reality out of it. Then we'll help you adjust to that. Here, we'll help you adjust to that. You know that isn't it. You know that isn't it. You know it. But it's difficult telling others that. You know, it's very difficult. That's why you might wonder, well, why have these great historical spiritual figures and those who have helped present that? How come, you know, it got muddled? Well, yeah, it isn't easy telling the old compassion that it isn't it. Unless you have the experience yourself of super compassion, you're not going to understand, and you're going to try to put it whatever's being you're told into the old context of okay, well, what you're really saying is this, yeah, okay, I'm not sure what you're saying, but it must be that you're trying to give me a better way to adjust to the destruction of creativity. Okay, thank you. You know, that's what happens. Okay, that's what happens. But if you have the direct experience of super compassion, then you can start putting it into the right context. You can start getting familiar with this. So let's not blame history. You know, the trouble is if you don't experience it directly, you can't put this good news into the right context. You really can't. And so you just try to adjust, you know, the old compassion and say, maybe there's better ways to adjust to the destruction of creativity and a new reality based on that. Maybe there's some better way to adjust to that. And that's how you take this. And that's, you know, that's the wrong take. It's a mistaken take. It's a very mistaken take. But what can you do? So, I mean, it's not easy to give this out but if there are those who have experienced it directly, it is easier to give this information out. It's still not easy because they're not familiar with it. They're like, you know, do I need to integrate this or not? You know, no, don't need to really integrate it. But you can be gentle and gracious about this not integrating it. Okay, you can be very gentle and gracious and honor our creativity. Okay, but without trying to integrate truth and lies. Okay. So it doesn't have to be a harsh no. It can be a gentle and gracious no. There's no way to integrate the old and new compassion. They're based on mutually exclusive premises. You know, one, the old compassion is based on the premise that creativity can indeed destroy creativity. And super compassion is based on the premise that creativity in no way can it change, harm, alter its perfect functionality as it was created. In no way can it do that. In no way can it do that. So very different premises, okay? Those are really mutual exclusive premises. You cannot integrate those two premises into some third premise that accommodates both and yet makes us happy. You know, that's not possible. It's not possible. So let us honor our creativity that we use to make us believe that maybe this was possible, right? And at the same time, acknowledge that it will never be possible. But do it in a gentle and gracious way. That's what super compassion helps us with, okay? We do say it's not possible. The impossible is not possible in any way, but we gently and graciously honor our creativity in how we have tried to make it seem plausible, right? That it's plausible. That's all we've done. We've made it just appear to be remotely plausible, maybe. But we used a super amount of creativity, cleverness, really, to make it seem plausible, to pretend that it's plausible. And we honor that, you know. It was really quite a show, right? Even it's like putting on some great opera, you know, some Wagnerian opera with just all the backdrops and the scenes and the sing and the shrieking. But you don't really like the music, you know. There's too much wailing and shrieking and drama, and you say, wow, I really hate the music, but. I can really tell it was quite a production. I mean, a lot of effort went in this production, and I can appreciate the effort that went into the production. I just didn't like the result of the production. Okay, but you do it in a gentle and gracious way, right? And you say, well, thanks. I was really, it was amazing production there. You know, quite amazing. It's indescribable of all the effort that went into the backdrops and the scenery and the costumes and the script and the score of the music and the coordination, and so much amazing effort was put into it. You know, I just didn't like the shrieking and the wailing of the Valkyries, you know, and the slaughter and all this stuff. But it was quite a big, amazing production, right? So this is what we're talking about in being gentle and gracious. No, but quite an honorable effort. Quite an honorable effort, you know? Just like that. Quite a noble effort, right? Quite a creative effort. I just really didn't like, you know, trying to destroy myself. It was a little, you know, too weird. A little too weird for me. Right? So you could, you know, if something's too weird for you, it's too weird, okay? So you say thanks, but no thanks. Like that, thanks, but no thanks. Just, it's not my cup of tea. It's amazing, but not my kind of amazing. And so super compassion helps us with this really gentle and gracious way of saying thanks but no thanks. We've had enough. We've had enough of the weirdness, haven't we? We really have. I'm not ready for another round of weirdness in the United States. I've had enough. I've had 60 years of it already. And that's more than enough, actually. So, I'm not going to go along with that. I don't want it. It's enough. Thanks, but no thanks. You know, the U.S. is set for a really big show, a really big production of really big weirdness. Okay. And, you know, I'm not going to attend that concert. Not going to attend that concert. I got another concert I'm going to attend. I really acknowledge your great efforts. You know, very extraordinary. But I'm going to attend this concert put on by Super Compassion. We've got this band playing. The band's called Super Compassion, and I want to hear their music. I'm interested in hearing that music. And I didn't attend the eclipse, for instance. I was in doing this writing. I was doing this writing, trying to present the new way. So I didn't even attend it. I forgot all about it, actually. I forgot all about it. And then I was reminded of, someone reminded me, you know, is the eclipse going? I said, oh, eclipse? Oh, my gosh, I forgot about it. And I went outside. It was too late. the most of it was over by that time. I guess it was a little dark. I looked at the sun. I put my camera on it and looked through the viewfinder of the camera. And I didn't see any obscuration of it, really. So I missed it. I kind of missed it. I saw a little diminishment of the light, a little bit. But it really wasn't much to see here in the Bay Area anyway. So, yeah, I mean, whereas others were up in Oregon, you know, attending this concert of the eclipse, you know, the darkness upon the land. They're really into darkness upon the land. I'm not into that. I'm not interested in seeing darkness upon this land. You know, I mean, I acknowledge that it's a really A lot of effort has been in prepared to bring, massive weirdness to the United States. A big concert, a big kind of Woodstock of weirdness, so to speak. But I have this other concert that I'm committed to attending. So, maybe we'll do this weirdness down the road somewhere. Possible, right? Not saying ruling it out entirely, right? But not right now. I'm tired of the weirdness. And this is a way we can all feel. And fortunately, we do have another concert to attend. Okay. One side, the old compassion was set to give this really weird concert, and then there's other venue that super compassion is about to give this really wonderful concert. A 7-year concert to start off with. A 7-year concert. That kind of tops Woodstock, doesn't it? It does. What was that? Several days, and we're going to get 7 years from super compassion just to start with. That's just the hors d'oeuvres, okay? We're going to get the hors d'oeuvres now. I mean, but hey, even the hors d'oeuvres are fabulous when it comes to super compassion. I'll tell you that. But we'll have plenty of time to get to the main course later, okay? Plenty of, we'll get to that later. The hors d'oeuvres are super fabulous in their own right, to say the least. Sometimes. If the chef is fancy enough, sometimes the hors d'oeuvres are like, wow, If there's a really big blowout, the rich people are putting this big blowout on. Man, the hors d'oeuvres are just like, you say, wow, this is like better than any most main courses that I've ever had. It is amazing, amazing stuff. What? And you just can't, you can't resist. It's great. So we're going to get amazing hors d'oeuvres here in the United States. Amazing hors d'oeuvres from Super Grace. The hors d'oeuvres of Super Grace are now being served. And you have these servers walking around with a tray. It's not like I'm really greatly familiar with the super rich. I've been invited to a couple occasions where you have these people walking around with trays and they have all these hors d'oeuvres on them and it just keeps coming and keeps coming and keeps coming. And it's like, holy cow, how tasty. Yeah. So. There may be, those who walk around like servers with the hors d'oeuvres of super compassion on these plates, on these platters, and saying, "Would you like some?" And yeah, help yourself, please. And some will say, "Yeah, I think I'll try this one. This looks really nice. Can I have this?" Of course. That's what's happening now. There's a super compassionist throwing a really big party. It's on super compassion. They're the ones throwing the party. 7-year party. So, yeah, have some. Absolutely. And maybe some will say, "Huh, yeah, I think I'm going to attend this party instead of the other party, right?" And then hopefully many will start gravitating, to that. Maybe they'll spend some time in the other party, and then they'll say, "Ah, this party's getting too weird. It's just getting too weird. I think I'm going to. I don't need to stay here through the 7-year duration. I can go over to this other party. There's another party going on. I don't want to be without a party because that's what's happening now. But I can go over to this other party, and let me check out the hors d'oeuvres. Other serving hors d'oeuvres. Great. Let me. What kind of hors d'oeuvres? They oh." I like that order. Let me try that. Wow. That's a wow hors d'oeuvre, isn't it? Holy cow. Wow. That's a great hors d'oeuvre. Wow. Yeah. And that helps us get familiar. Warms us up for the main course, doesn't it? The real homecoming, the main course, it warms us up. It gets our appetite going for it, right? We need to have our appetite, awakened, and so these hors d'oeuvres will help our appetite, develop our appetite, and get us ready to really consume the main course somewhere down the road, right? Somewhere down the road. I don't even know what that would be like, but really the ultimate homecoming ultimately will truly happen for us, yes, down the road, maybe quite a ways, but yet we're having the hors d'oeuvres now. So you know, when you have the hors d'oeuvres, you know that the courses are coming. The courses are coming. The main course is on its way at some point. Have the hors d'oeuvres, and then there may be, you know, some kind of other stuff too, and then some, you know, some drinks, beverages here, and refreshments, and some talk, and then you know, eventually the main course starts getting served, but people are warmed up to it by that time. They're warmed up to it. They're familiar with it, and so we have quite a ways to go before we get to the main course. So don't be worried about that. It's not going to be stuffed down our throats and sort of choke on it. You got to, before you get to the main course, you got to loosen up the, you know, the stomach, the esophagus, get everything ready. That's why they have, you know, warm tea and like soup and some bread, and kind of get you ready. Get you ready. You don't want to just cold just start wolf down some, you know, real big main course. You gotta choke on it. I did that yesterday. I was so busy running around and so nervous, and I just was eating, standing up, eating a bunch of water, and before you know it, wouldn't go down. You know, wouldn't go down in the stomach because my esophagus was tight. Ugh, that's uncomfortable, isn't it? And then I told myself, hey, you know, you slow down, settle down, you know, start with something to drink, a few little pieces of food that's easy to digest, and just start that way. Start slowly. And so I finally cleared my gullet, as they say, and then started eating a little, sat down, you know, started going a little more slowly, and everything was okay. So that was just kind of showing me, you know, hey, we don't need to start out too strongly. We don't need to start out too strongly, but we do need to start out. We need to start hearing the first notes of the party. Maybe we hear something on the breeze, we hear some, oh, what's that? I remember recently I went to a very beautiful place, and we arrived there, and in the distance there was this music. You know, it was like 500 yards away or more. It was, you know, it was quite distant, but it was calm and clear, and the sound was carrying beautifully through the atmosphere. And so in the distance I heard this beautiful music, wow. I was just like, oh, that is so wonderful. What a beautiful welcome. What a beautiful welcome. Way to be welcomed. What a welcoming that was for me. I just arrived after a long, long 2 days of driving, and we were so tired and exhausted. It was so stressful, and we finally arrived there to our destination. And it was dark at night. And what do I hear? The beautiful stars are out, and there's gorgeous music in the distance, wafting through the atmosphere. I said, hallelujah. Wow. And I felt very welcome at that. From that point, I said, wow, this is going to be great. And that was like the hors d'oeuvre. That was an hors d'oeuvre. And then the sprinklers went on. All this beautiful water was spraying everywhere, watering there. And that was also wonderful, just to sit there and watch that. Because really, with the drought in California, we haven't seen that for a long time. Just all these sprinklers watering grass, you know, you just didn't see that very much, you know. And just to see that, like, was like wonderful. So there's beautiful music, and the sprinklers are just powerfully sprinkling this vast expanse of lawn, beautiful green lawn, where a lot of lawns up here in the Bay Area, you know, died. We let them die. Drought was so horrible. So to experience this, these were like the hors d'oeuvres saying, you know what, things are going to get a lot better for you. And here's a few wonderful hors d'oeuvres for you. So I had a wonderful time on that little break, couple days break, in a beautiful place. It was so gentle and gracious. The surroundings were so gentle and gracious. So I know this is what's coming. It was a way of super compassion to let me know this is what's coming. Really gentle graciousness is coming, and you're going to get it in this, like, hors d'oeuvres that are going to come maybe at a distance for you, and we'll warm you up to it. Don't worry, we'll warm you up to it. And It was really an amazing time for me. It was all I could handle. It was so wonderful. I really could hardly handle any more wonderful. It's like I said, don't pinch me. It's like a dream. It's so gentle and gracious, and there's nothing interfering with it. I said, this is just like some kind of ultimate dream, you know, but it's actually happening. So super compassion was letting me know it's going to be like this. It's going to be like this. Wow. A little bit at a time, but it'll be plenty for you. Okay, it's not like you're going to be lacking. It's not like I said, hey, this isn't good enough. I was, my jaw was on the floor, you know, I saying, my goodness, you know, this is way better than I expected. I expected it would be good, but this is way better than expected. Wow. Yeah, I mean, my mouth was hanging open. I was just looking at the scenery and where I was at and what was going on. And I'm just saying, like, thank you, thank you, thank you. Wow, 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 thank you, thank you. Blessings, blessings. I so much appreciate this. What, you know, gratitude. It was like that. It's a feeling like of constant gratitude. Gratitude just didn't end. It was like seamless gratitude. I just saying, it's like listening to unbelievably beautiful music, and you just that feeling like, wow, I love this. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. So, what is the song that Super Compassion plays for us? This is what we're going to find out now, starting today. Starting today, 21st of August, 2017. We're going to start hearing the song that Super Compassion plays for us. And this is, you know, a metaphor of, you know, for the feeling of hearing a really, really sweet song. I mean, just like, wow. I mean, how does that make you feel? You know, but just, you know, how is the music, that's the song that Super Compassion is going to sing for us and play for us, how is that going to feel? How is that going to feel? It's going to feel wow, right, is the best way to describe it, wow. And out of the blue, you know, it's just out of the blue. Like I arrived at this place and I didn't expect this music to be played. I said, where's it coming from? We didn't even know where it was coming from. So what's going on? Like, is there some sort of welcome wagon, you know, here? We arrive and suddenly the, you know, the Super Compassion starts playing this, one of my favorite songs, Sleepwalk by Johnny and Santo. And it's so beautiful. Yeah. I said, what is going on? I mean, this is like almost too good to be true. So we might not even know, like, what, you know, what's going on? Where is this coming from? Where is this Super Compassion coming from? Yeah, it's just like it's in the air. Yeah, it's just suddenly it's in the air. I'm just feeling it. Yeah, that you know, it could happen like that. That we just start feeling it. And we don't really know at first where it's coming from. It took a while for me to realize it's coming from way over there. And there's some restaurant that some band is playing at some restaurant. It took a while. At first, we didn't know where it was coming from. So that was really a wonderful experience, just to get this super great welcome. And not even know who's doing it and where it's coming from at all. And we're just kind of smiling and laughing, just saying, wow, this is this is really great. And so this Super Compassion has let me know this is how it's going to be. It's just, you know, we're not even really sure where it's coming from at first. Now I now know it's coming from Super Compassion. Okay, but that's kind of, it's kind of nebulous, right? You know, but that's fine. Nebulous is okay. I've already experienced this. Nebulous is okay. And I had a smile on my face. I'm saying, okay, I knew this was coming from Super Compassion. And my friend did too. He said, oh, this is a blessing. This is really a blessing, isn't it? I said, yeah, you're right. That's exactly what it is. I had a friend there with me who was tuned into Super Compassion in some way. And so we knew. We both knew that this is coming from Super Compassion. Wow. Okay. And that we didn't really need to know anything more. And you know, we didn't need to know the name of the band or the name of the restaurant or what kind of food they were serving or any of this kind of stuff. We just said, okay, we understand what this is for. And that's good enough. It's good enough. So when you get this feeling of Super Compassion, you know, you're feeling it And you say, oh, this is coming from super compassion. Okay, that's good enough. We don't need to know all these, you know, labels for it, right? We don't really, it's good enough. We know what it's for, and that's enough. That's good enough. We're being welcomed. We're being welcomed. The welcome wagon is rolling out the welcome, right? With a song and a dance for us. And we're saying, great, great, wow. This is really great. This person, this man that was with me, I just met him the day before. I'd never met him before in my life. And he was wonderful. He was wonderful. He got it. You know, he was very in tune with that, yeah, super compassion does happen. It does exist. And it's okay to not try to dissect it, you know. Dissection of super compassion isn't where it's at all. It's too vast for that. It's too wonderful for that. It's just let it be the way that it is. Just let it be. Let super compassion be. Just let it be. Now, the old pseudo-compassion, really, we felt like we needed to dissect it and label it and try, because it really didn't work. We thought maybe if we understand it better, maybe it'll work. It'll work better. But super compassion really works. So we don't have this need to feel like I need to make it better. I need to label it, categorize it, put layers and levels onto it, understand it, you know, critique it, dissect it, analyze it. I don't need to do any of that, because it works beautifully, just the way it is. And so you don't feel any need to do that. Whereas with the old pseudo-compassion, definitely, we felt, my goodness, you know, we gotta make this better. You know, let's take it apart. Let's disassemble it and find out what the heck. Disassemble and find out what's going on here. Maybe we need to rearrange this because it's just really not working that great at all. We felt that need to do that. That's the old way, involved with absurdity, panic, fear. Pseudo-compassion, the premise that creativity can destroy creativity. We felt we needed to label everything and define everything and categorize and analyze and do all that, you know, and do all this stuff and be clever about it. We don't have that feeling towards super compassion. That feeling just doesn't exist. We don't feel any need to do that. We just say, just let it be, just as it is. I don't need to try and reverse engineer anything. I don't need to disassemble anything. I don't need to ask questions about it, really. I don't need to question it. I don't need to interrogate it. I don't need to grill it. I don't need to, you know, just let it be, just as it is. I don't need to integrate it with the old pseudo-compassion either. Again, thanks, but no thanks. You know, an honor, but we honor our creativity in putting on this really big show that we've been watching for quite some time, right? For a lot of moments have gone by where we're watching this big show of a universe, right? This big display, this big show of creativity destroying creativity. We're kind of like, and fearfully, you know, watching like watching a scary movie. And we've been watching this scary movie for a really long, long time, right? A lot of moments. And so we just say, hey, you know, that there's a lot of big production went into this scary movie, you know. A lot of sets, a lot of effort, yeah. So we honor that. It's really a big, big effort on our part. But we're also not going to watch it anymore. We're headed home, you know, we're headed home, back from, no more scary movies, no more scary movies. So, yeah, I guess I gotta get started on my day. I got up really early to do this, I couldn't sleep, not that I have much work actually, maybe it was planned out that way, that I have a kind of a lull in work. I don't really feel like I can even work much today, I'm so, you know, tired and exhausted, but I'll find a way to have a second wind here. So this video, you know, turned out better than expected. I don't know how, I didn't know how it would turn out. But I was able to really convey, you know, better than expected, which is, you know, what we're looking for here in the new way, better than expected. So what a great day for the United States. And the United States deserves this. It absolutely deserves this. A lot of people who've been part of the United States have tried to find a better way. We really have. And we don't want to see, you know, the ship sink. We really don't. So we're going to do everything possible so the ship doesn't sink, actually. Too much kindness has been here. A lot of kindness has come from the United States. You know, the old ways of compassion were really tried here in so many different ways. And so we tried. There were a lot of trying here, the United States. So many people tried to make a difference in the world, tried to be charitable, tried to be compassionate, tried. So much trying, okay? Now, when you try a lot and it doesn't work, a lot of frustration arrives. So a lot of people are very frustrated now, okay? But, you know, trying is part of it. You know, when you make the great effort and it doesn't work, that really can lead to you to trying a new way, to really making a fundamental shift. It can. So don't put it past the United States that here that we there may be some that really are willing to make this fundamental shift to super compassion. Because they've tried all the other ways. They really have tried so much, and suffered from it, and are willing to try something really fundamentally different. So we'll find out what happens, won't we? We'll find out what happens. Should be very compelling, very interesting, very hopeful. You know, I don't have my hopes too high. You know, I know there's a lot of frustration here in this country right now, from every direction, actually, from every direction. A lot of hope trying to go this way, and a lot of people trying to put out the fire, you know, pouring fire on other, put, you know, on other people's hope in this way and in that way, in every which way, you know, whatever. No matter what you try to do here, it seems like there's factions that want to put you down. So it's kind of like, you know, gridlock. It's like, wow, we can't seem to go in any direction whatsoever. But lo and behold, this unexpected direction of super compassion has arrived on the scene today. And so, well, goes without saying, tremendous gratitude towards super compassion, which is really tremendous gratitude towards ourselves, because super compassion really is our own creativity. Using our creativity to gently and graciously set aside this idea that we've been playing with of trying to destroy creativity, destroy ourselves. It's really our own creativity, super compassion. That's where it really comes from. But it seems, for a while, it'll seem like, you know, it just, we don't know really where it comes from. It's so wonderful. But we're really having compassion for ourselves, you know, gratitude to ourselves for, you know, having compassion on ourselves. Yeah. Great compassion here. Great compassion. And, you know, we may feel, you know, like a band is playing a song, we might thank the musicians, you know, for a while. But it's really us that's playing the song. All of us are playing the song. But it may seem, for a while, it may seem like, well, wow, there are these wonderful musicians that have shown up and they're playing this wonderful music. Thank you, thank you, thank you. And we may feel that way of sort of like personifying, you know, super compassion. We might feel that way, or we might not. We might just let it be. Just no, it's just super compassion. We don't really need to give any labels to the musicians. It's possible we might be that way. It's just super compassion. It's playing this wonderful song. Yeah. So this is an option that we have, right? We don't need to say, well, you know, it's this or this, or this wonderful personal being, or this wonderful, you know, try to delineate it and sort of personify it in some way. We might not even feel like we need to do that. I don't know. Maybe it'll be very, very non-personified. That's possible. squirrel's having its breakfast over there, eating a walnut. Sounds like it's having a lot of fun eating that walnut. Really nice. Speaking of that, maybe I should get some breakfast at some point. So it's been really great sharing this with all of you, with everyone in the United States, everyone around the world, whoever happens to tune in. And we'll bring this to a close now. As I go about my day, you go about your day, and we let this tremendously great good news sink in, and, you know, I'll keep you updated as, you know, guided to do so by super compassion. I don't really have any agenda one way or other of how that will happen. I just, when if I get some notification or something to pass along, and it's time to do it, I'll say, okay, we'll see if I can do it. You know, I'll do my best. All right, very great, and keep in mind that super compassion is really, wow, it's better than expected. Count on that, it will be better than expected, and you're just gonna feel the wow. Super compassion is wow.